Okay, boys, would you believe it? And girls, for the last time ever, this is your Thursday night entertainment. This is Sim Racing Team Challenge. Eckhard von Glanz speaking to you live from the north of Germany. With me tonight, Andreas Hultgren. Hello, Andreas.
Hello.
And of course, Jose Estrada. Hello, Jose.
Hello.
And yes, it is the final race in the final season of the Sim Racing Team Challenge. We are at Virtual Portimao in Algarve, in Portugal, and this is your grid. In the final position on the grid, position 25, we find Ethan Bass of Flying Dutchman Development. Position 24, that is Carlos Costa of AB Racing, and they are Portuguese, so it's their home ground here. Position 23, David Clark for Flat Out Club. Position 22, Mikael Larsson for the Blue Flag. Position 21, Collis Stroe from the Clubin UD. Position 20, Theo de Bruyne, also for the Blue Flag. Position 19, João Castelho, second of the Portuguese team's Sonic Racing. Position 18, Nick Dealey, Flying Dutchman Development. Position 17, Andy Roberts, Flat Out Club. Position 16, Massimo Martin for the Corso Online from Italy. Position 15, Peracterios from Sweden for Gutklubben UD. Position 14, Thiago Orfao for AB Racing. Position 13, last of the three title contender teams, Göran Johansson for Gupkluben. Position 12, Matthias Klein for Torrent Motorsports. Position 11, Kevin Ledoux for the Black Rebels. Position 10, Kane Lesky for the Torrents. Position 9, Dinka Andre for Waterblue Racing. Position 8, Grégory De Greef for Black Rebels Racing, then Emil Selberg in 7 for Waterblue Racing. In 6 we find Jesper Taulborg for title contenders Flying Dutchman. In 5 Robin Johansson for contenders Gupkluben. In 4 Ben Tusting, and we have a bit of a pile up here. Tusting has to go outside. Never mind, Ben, go back in. Ben Tusting, and we're starting the race in half a second. In 3 Tyler Skerlock. In 2 Marco Giolato, out to spoil it for everyone here. As the black sheep among all these wolves. And then in 1, Mike Simeon for the defending champions and hot contenders. Flat out, and off he goes, up the hill and down the hill. Seems to just wait and see what is going on here in the top or at the top of the grid. And I don't know about the back of the grid because I really have no chance at all. Andreas, what could you see there?
Well, a lot of smoke to begin with, but I think 7 cars were involved in that crash. And Thiago Orfao was one of them, Massimo Martin, definitely one of them, because he's missing a rear wing and it's fun again. David Clark, Carlos Costa, Gregory De Greef.
Gregory De Greef, it went up to that position because he was on the grid, he was an 8. So it really was in the middle of the field, was not even in the back of the field, was smack in the middle of the field. But racers are now approaching the start and finish line. And I don't think I can see David Garcia's PCR anywhere to be a yellow flag here. So what are the reasons?
Kane Lesky is out of the race as well due to the crash, and well, Massimo Martin is also out, and in Selberg as well.
Yep, Martin out of the server as well here. Probably absolutely frustrated with the last of the STC races for him, only the last as well. But the outlap, and then didn't even get to the start of finish line, so as you can see, this all happened before they even crossed.
Yeah, I think just over the crest there.
Yep. Oh dear, oh dear. Well, at the top of the field we have Maximian going now here into a sharp right-hander, and it's an uphill turn. And then he is followed by Giuliano, who is cleaning out to that position number two. What was that? Oh,
because
yes, there was a collision involving an FDR car, called Jesper.
Yep, it's the Talboy and Gincandei, I think.
Oh dear, are they both back on track?
Yep, in Talboy in 9th and Andrei in 10th.
Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. So everything's working out nicely here for the flat out at the moment, even though they are not involved at all. They're up at the front, doing what they do best, racing very, very fast indeed. And some of their troubles are taking care of themselves, it seems. We have Tusting in 4, and we have Simeon in 1. And from the looks of it, Giuliato is really extremely fast here. He leaves Skurlock behind, and Skurlock, make no mistake, he's one of the fastest guys out there. And he's actually starting to hunt down Maximian. Look at that, he's much closer than he was last lap. Than he was last lap. And you see players going out a little bit here off the track. We follow the most basic of all cutting rules here in the STC, which is if the game doesn't penalize you, we won't either. So players really have a lot of choices to make as they go through this. And then basically what every team does in the testing phase before the race is see how far can we go with a line that still saves time. I mean, some of the lines don't save time, but how far can we go with a line that still saves time and that is still legal and the game won't say anything. And yes, indeed, Giuliato is really putting the pressure here on Simeon. And he is getting closer and closer and closer. Another lap or so before he catches him. And if I were Mike, I would simply let him pass, because, of course, we are way out for the championship, for the overall standing. So why fight him?
Yes, and in P4 and 5, we have the second of the flat out cars being attacked by Robin Johansson from Kluven. Quite intense fight now.
Yeah, thank you, Jose, for that. And Kluven, of course, really must try to get past as quickly as possible. These are two of the title contenders. And we see the second of the Kluven cars already up to seven in the back. That means that Göran Johansson has moved up 6 positions already. He must have somehow survived the starting crash. And he is now attacking Kevin Ledoux of the Black Rebels, just down the road. Let's stay with Robin Johansson. Robin Johansson following Ben Tusting in the Königsegg, so a Swedish guy following a Swedish ride here. Königsegg, of course, is a small manufacturer from Sweden. And, well, from what I have seen here, the last half lap or so, Johansson is indeed just a little bit faster than Tusting, but it looks as if Tusting is a bit faster on the straights, doesn't it? Or else Johansson has the edge in the turns.
It sure does look like that. And actually, I'm looking a bit further up with Giuliato now chasing Simon. And well, the gap doesn't get any bigger, almost like as it gets smaller.
Ooh, and Johansson now very close to Tusting, and that means Johansson has to go offline because Tusting, defending his line, cut into the front of him. Absolutely fair racing there. Because Johansson, and here's Johansson making a progress, and he's pulling back. But this is it's a fantastic track, isn't it, for Timao? It's a track that really allows you a couple of ways to take each turn, Andreas.
Yeah. And a lot of height differences as well, which always makes a track much better, in my opinion.
It certainly does, it certainly does. Though I like Hockenheim very much, that's the one thing that is missing is up and down, isn't it?
Yep.
Especially in here, some of the turns, you go uphill, and then the turn is right behind the crest, and you don't know, you can't see actually what's there, if somebody has spun out or something, and you really have to delve into the unknown, and then hope that everything's fine once you get to the top of the crest. And here they go, down the straight, Tusting, and he now has Johansson in his slipstream. They both go out here, approaching T1, and they also go out this way. Oh, and Johansson's Corvette is very, very unstable. He really has to fight to stay it on the track. This is intense sim racing here, and on a very high level technically. And now Johansson has to decide. I tell you, there's going to be another try because either the next 3 turns or a little bit later. And Tusting very late on the race,
sorry again, Eckhart, please, I have a lot of engine noise.
There's a huge crash, position 10, 11, 12, somewhere around there, even before players crossed the start and finish line. Did you see anything at all?
No, not really, Eckhart, because I was just checking the formation. It was nice before reaching the last part of the long corner.
Okay.
At the end of the lap, and
right.
it looked really clean when we showed the green lights.
It did. And Simeon yeah. kind of was slow at first, and then he sped off as is his. It's perfectly correct. Everything well done. And then when Simeon passed start and finish, we just saw in the background a torrent flipping in the air, lots of small cars everywhere. It was a completely unusual sight for us to see.
Yeah, and especially, Eckhart, you have to remember that Portimao doesn't have a difficult corner at the end. It's almost a straight.
Yep.
So
yep.
I can't understand.
Neither can I.
Well, possibly, you know, it's a kind of reaction when the car leading brakes. The braking used to be harder and harder and harder back to the field. So it was a kind of hard braking. In those spots, so maybe the accident was something related to the slow speed and the head.
Yep. And now we see Johansson very close to Tasting, sniffing at his exhausts there, and going out here. He always takes that very outside line in that turn, and obviously gets some a cool speed as he exits. Look at that. He's up to Tasting again. And up to now, he doesn't find a way back, but it's extremely close. The Corvette is now on the inside. Can he sneak through on that turn here? He tries to find a way somewhere. There's an uphill part again, with again the apex of the turn just behind the crest. This is what is so lovely about Portimao, is that the apexes, you can't really see the apexes as you go, and you just have to trust your instinct that you remember where they were. And now we have this last turn, which, as David said, it's not really a difficult. Well, it's difficult if you're at high speed, but if you're slow, as in the outlap, it's not really difficult at all. And this is the difficult part, is that if you get carried away, I mean, it's always difficult if you get carried away, but if you get carried outside just a little too much here, you definitely get a cut warning. And I suppose we'll see one or two stop and goes here with people going too far on the outside on that turn. Well, Andreas, it looks as if Tasting can hold Johansson off, doesn't it?
So far, yes.
How much longer do you give?
I don't know. He's very mature. He knows which line to take.
And he takes the defense. And look at that, he's even closing in on Skirlaxon rather than just defending. He's actually sitting on this three pace is feeling the heat now of the testing attacking. So that is quite unusual. And it looks to me as if Johansson has, for the time being, given a little help. And he's not pushing too much. Maybe he's hoping the testing is very understimulated.
Yeah, and at the same time, it's a hard tracking part on no real happens, or it's super hard brakes, so and you would think that turn one should be a tight corner, but it's pretty fast there.
It is, and again, the only problem is don't get too far to the outside, because there's a couple of them waiting there. Look at that,
it is,
definitely. David, we are rhapsodizing. We're very optimistic here. It's a good track on Portimao. What's your experience at Virtual Portimao? Done any interesting games yet?
Well, I it's a long time. I don't have a race in the Virtual Portimao card, but I think it's a circuit everybody enjoys, because the difference in heights between the sectors of the circuit. You have a lot of downhill, uphill, and of camber corners, blind corners. It's a dare for a driver.
And this is a Western.
Oh, and here's the attack, here's the attack. Here is Johan Son, and he's slipping past. He's... Oh, that was so clever. That was so outstanding. Tusting had to slow down, trying to find a way past Skurlock, and just that little bit of slowing down brought Tusting the kind of disadvantage that Johansson had been looking for all along. Now, how clever was that? Absolutely marvelous move by Robin Johansson, and he is now the one to chase down Tyler Skurlock. But Jose, let's move the camera down just two positions to Kevin Ledoux, because there's another battle there. Kevin Ledoux in six has Göran Johansson and Jesper Talborg on his back. I mean, Jesper had to recover from a little get-together with, we think, De Grief, or...
No, I think it was Dinka Andre.
Sorry, Dinka Andre. Okay, with Dinka Andre, who's a bit further down the line here. And he has obviously recovered, and he's trying to regain the positions that he's lost. And it's a very close battle, three-way battle again, with Johansson in the, well, very hot spot here, at the same time having to put pressure on... number six on Kevin Ledoux, and at the same time having to defend against number eight, Jesper Talborg. And indeed, we see that on Talborg's Corvette, the rear right lights are crashed, so there must have been a contact there, I think.
But this is a very nice fight as well, and I think Jesper is looking as well for a good spot or a good moment to do a move, because it will depend on how many points and how many positions can Jesper recover.
Definitely, definitely. At the moment, everything's playing into... Ooh, very close indeed. That was... Ledoux had a hard time getting out of one of these turns, and he had both of the Corvettes all over his back, but that Ford is defending his position, I think, just as clever as Tusting was doing before. He's not really taking a defensive line, but he's taking it just defensive enough to keep these other two from passing.
Yeah, I agree. He's doing a nice job. I have been talking with Kevin before the race, we know the car is not fast enough compared with the other cars on the grid. We maybe did a wrong decision at the start of the season. And I have to say that Kevin is doing a hell of a job right now, keeping
yep.
the two Corvettes behind.
Yep, look at that. They get really close on the straight. I mean, he really has to take the last turn before any straight in perfect shape. And then at the end of the straight, they're all over him. And he manages to... Well, at least have a stable gap in the more curvy parts here, the more tricky technical parts. And obviously, the straights are the problem. Here's the attack. Nope, Talborg moves back in. I thought there was an attack coming there, but Jesper decides to pull back and maybe try it another time.
I think the key for granting the Jesper's overtake could be having Kevin in front, because Göran is being a bit slow, maybe, than what he could have been. I mean, he could be faster if he got no Kevin in front.
Definitely.
And I think this is giving more options for an overtaking move for Jesper.
Yep, and maybe we see the kind of maneuver that we just saw, that guy number three uses the battle between guy number one and two to step past, but at the moment, The two title contenders, Gutkoven and Flying Dutchman, are so much involved with each other that Ledoux simply pulls away a little and says, okay boys, you slug it out in the back there, leave me alone, that's nice, I'm taking a little break here and I'm rushing off, look at that. He gained something like half a second or 1 second, we just won that, well done.
Now Jesper is very close, I got.
Yep. Don't get all of you up to date about title standings. Didn't have time at the beginning of our broadcast here. It's Flat Out Racing at 417 points after 9 races, followed by Flying Dutchman Racing, 18 points down at 399, and then followed by Gutkloppen, another 36 points down. 39 points down at 360. So really, Gutkloppen's chances are theoretical at best, but the Flying Dutchman, they still really have a sporting chance if they can somehow turn some events here in the race for their advantage. At the moment, with Tusting in 4, with Johansson in 3, with Skurlock, Johansson in 4, sorry. Let's put it the other way around. Simeon in 1, Skurlock in 3, Johansson in 4, Tusting in 5.
No, Eckert, I think you got confused.
Yes.
With Johansson. It's Jesper in 8.
Yes, yes, sorry. And with the other Johansson in 7 and Jesper Talborg in 8, the points would be something like this. Hang on.
Well, Eckert make his numbers. Andreas, don't you think that it would be very important for Flying Dutchman if Jesper could pass Goran and Kevin?
Well, yeah. As it looks right now,
here we go. Yeah.
Yeah, in turn 3, or maybe it was already in turn 2, but it's a clean pass, and I think Johansson made it a bit easy, actually.
Okay, I want to point that my comment was not a team order or something related.
No.
Because I just said that this would be very important for them, and then Jesper made the move.
Yeah, well, at the moment, Flatout is in a better position, but 18 points separating the two teams, it can switch quite fast, to be honest.
Yeah, but still, I think if now Jesper can overtake Kevin, and then with the pit strategy and everything, maybe he could get closer to Ben Tusting, even if he's still far away, but...
Yeah, and maybe we should go to the lead, Jose, but because Mike Simon is under pressure, at least, from Marco Juliaco, who has caught a bit of time again.
Okay, but maybe we can do it in the first rundown, Eckart, if we want.
Sounds good. I've made up the numbers at the time, and I suppose they're wrong, and I suppose Tom Ilsbrooks will call us in half a second and say, listen, you got your numbers wrong again. I'm not leaving the best impression here number-wise, but position number 1 at the moment for... Mike Simeon, and he's been there in the qualification. That means they have 1 point already from the pole position, and this would be 32 points for him. Then in position number 2, we have Marco Giuliato for the course online. Indeed, ooh, and sliding into the turns here, Giuliato really on edge, trying to get some advantage here on Mike Simeon. In 3, Tyler Skurlock for Flying Dutchman. That would mean 26 points for them. In 4, Robin Johansson for the Gubklubben, that would mean 24 points for them. 23 points for them. In 5, Ben Tusting for Flat Out, that would mean 22 points for them, which would give them an overall of 55 points at the moment. Then Kevin Ledoux for the Black Rebels in 6th, under huge pressure now from Jesper Talborg in 7 for Flying Dutchman, which would mean 20 more points, which would give them 46 points at the moment. And then in 8, Göran Johansson for Gubklubben, which would give them 19 points, which would sum up to 42 at the moment. So at the moment what we have is that the positions would be the same as before the race, just that the gaps would open up a little bit. So at the moment Flat Out would be champions, followed by Flying Dutchman, followed by Gubklubben. But there's Dinka André in position number 9 for Waterblue Racing, still very much following the top teams here. Very great job by Dinka. Then in position number 10, Matthias Klein for the Torrent. Position number 11, Mikael Larsson for Gubklubben. It's Swedish. Sorry, guy. Mikael Larsson, not for Gubklubben, but of course for Blue Flag Racing. How can I not know that it's my team? Never mind, this will go down as my worst mistake of the season. And he is up from, Larsson is up from 22, so he is up 11 positions. He must have done a very convenient slalom around these, the spectacle that we saw at the start, around the cars flying everywhere. And he's up in 11. In 12, another Swedish guy, this time for Gubklubben for sure, Gubklubben UD, Per Akterius. And he's up from 15. In position 13, under a lot of pressure from De Graeff, it's Collis Ström, also for Gubklubben in the Gumpert. He's up from 21. In 14, Gregory De Graeff, who is just now passing Ström. And he is down from 8. Then in position number 14 now, Collis Ström. In position number 15, Andy Roberts for Flat Out Club. And there's a nice bit of racing going on here in the back of the field, as you can see. Roberts, by the way, up from 17. In 16, Theo de Bruin up from 20. And then followed in 17 by David Clark, again of the Flat Out Club. Clark, who usually kind of skips the qualification to start from the back, to not be involved in any trouble. That's the way I read him. And then he's slowly moving up the field and usually ends up somewhere in 15, 16, sometimes even up to 12 or so. I think that's very neat tactics there, David Clark for Flat Out Club. The attack on Theo de Bruin. Let's see if we can make it stick. De Bruin chooses a very late, very, very late. Ooh, and Clark even loses a position because look at that style. He's very cautious, is David Clark, and De Bruin defends, and that means that slipping into 17, it is Ethan Bass at this point. Ooh, and now De Bruin gets hit by Ethan Bass, and he has to let the two of them pass. De Bruin out, but back in. Ooh, and another crash here by David Clark and Ethan Bass. So, Clark and Theo de Bruin in 18, down in 19, Carlos Costa for AB Racing. In 20, Nick Deely for Flying Dutchman Development. He's actually down two positions. In 21, Joao Castellos for Sonic. He's down from 19. And that is all the players still left on the track. So while we are going back to position number 1, where Andreas tells me the show is really heating up between Giuliato and Mike Simeon, with our first rundown here, I had a chance to kind of look who is missing from the grid. And it seems that in the opening crash, we have lost Emil Selberg of Waterloo Racing, who was in 7. We have De Graeff dropped down like 10, 12 positions. The second one we have missing is Thiago Orfao, I think of Sonic Racing or of AB Racing. And then we also have missing Martin. And sorry, at the moment, I'm not quite sure which team he was in, so I can't tell you that.
Course Online, I believe.
Course Online. Ah, Massimo Martin, yes indeed. So we have one Course guy out, we have one Waterloo guy out, and we have, I think, either
and
one
we have
AB...
For the lead,
we have a battle for the lead, and we have a huge battle for the lead between Mike Simeon and the second Course Online guy. And here comes Giuliato. He's now on the correct side, and look at that. Simeon knows that if he really wages his battle, he could lose the championship at this point. So he makes a very wise move indeed. And we have a new race leader, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen. This is Marco Giuliato for Course Online. And he is now leading the race. Mike Simeon in 2, deciding to rather take 29, to rather lose 3 points and take 29 than to lose it all.
Yeah, and he had a couple of lunches before as well. When you were doing the the grid rundown, he almost tapped him in the rear at the end of the start-finish straight. and lost a bit of time, and then he was almost side by side at another moment. So he did try a few times before it worked.
Yeah, fantastic, absolutely fantastic performance here by Giuliato. It's always good to see one of the teams that are not really at the top all of the time, to see one of these teams actually go for the win, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Yes, and Giuliato played it very, very intelligent now, because he knows the pressure is for Simeon, that he cannot risk to have an accident. So if he shows a lot of aggressivity, most likely he will let him go. And
indeed.
Yeah.
If he does like the gentleman type of racing, Simeon will say, well, so what? I can stay in front. But look at the gap he's opening. I mean, this is about the place where he passed last lap. And he's already up like half a second or so. And they're running up to the first lapping maneuver, first blue flag maneuver of the race. And what's the timing? Does anyone have a look at the watch? It should be about half an hour.
You have a look in the watch. We have Göran Johansson at pit. I think the pit window just started.
Okay, and what's the time?
57 minutes to go.
All right, does that look like a two-stopper to you?
Yes, it does.
It certainly does to me, which is, yeah, let's see what comes of that. I would be very curious, or I am very curious. And here goes the lapping maneuver, no problem at all, and well done by the Sonic player there. And Simeon slips past just as well, and can't take advantage of the slipstream on the straight, so that is absolutely and totally fair here. And Giuliato gets carried out of that turn one, but not far enough for a warning, so he takes all the speed out onto the straight. And as we see that, not only Göran Johansson is down in 13, but also Robin Johansson is following Mikael Larsson, his Swedish fellow, in 9 and 10. It looks as if both of the Gruppklubben Corvettes actually pitted very early and maybe go for a two-stopper here at Portimao.
If they are going for a two-stopper, it will be interesting to see what the Flying Dutchman are doing with the same, with the same car.
Yep, but I suppose that the Gruppklubben actually, I mean, the only chance they have is to do something surprising, and that might be behind the strategy.
Yep, well, a risky thing to do with both cars, though.
they have nothing to lose. I mean, they are pretty safe in position number 3. There's a huge gap to number 4. Let's have a quick look at the overall standings. It's Flying Dutchman Development. They're about 100 points down, so even if none of their cars reach the finish, they'll still be in 3. So what the heck?
Right.
They really have nothing to lose. So they go for, either this or nothing at all.
Yeah, still, Rodin was up there in 4th.
He was going fast. He was going fast indeed. But now all the other teams have to contend with the first lapping maneuvers, and they're pretty much out of it. So that might be one of the upsides here, one of the positive sides of this maneuver.
Andy Roberts at pit, guys.
Yep, next guy pitting in, and Johansson has already passed Mikael Larsson, and he is moving up the grid just the way he should.
I was checking the lap times, Eckhart, and it looked like Tyler Scarlock have been slightly faster than Mike Simeon in the last 4 or 5 laps, so I am not sure if he will be able to close the gap, because it is right now like 11, 12 seconds.
Oh dear, that's a long way away. Yeah, but I suppose that Simeon will be. I suppose that Simeon will be looking after his tires now, because he obviously lost. It was a really hot fight against Giulietto earlier on, and now I think he is definitely trying to conserve as much of the Koenigsegg as possible as he heads into the pit stop window, and trying to make the best of it. And here we are then in. In position 17, 16 and 15, with a massive fight between Carlos Costa for AB Racing, Nick Dealey for the Flying Dutchman Development, and Theo de Bruin in our pink BFR Pagani Zonta. And while the two others are playing hide and seek, Theo is nicely left alone, but I don't think for long. I think that in this group here, Nick Dealey at this point has the fastest ride, that's the Audi. And he is now trying to reach out and not touch Theo de Bruin, but get past Theo de Bruin, as they had around Portimao here in virtual Portugal.
Also behind these three, we have another fight between Kolleström and Raul Castellos.
Ah, even closer, that one.
Yeah.
And
Castellos.
Just say if the camera could move there. Castellos tries to pass Kolleström, but they're side by side, and up the hill they go. And Ström is now in the better position. Ooh. And very close, and here they go. Castellos sticks to a line that I suppose was not quite his. And Ström goes out again here, and Castellos has moved past. Which brings us back to these guys fighting for 15, 16 and 17, but at the time it's not really much of a fight, because they're nicely and evenly spread out here on the start and finish straight. And they are, the race leader is actually getting close, so it's about time to think about the pit stop here for these three, because that is one of the neat things to do is if there's a blue flag situation coming up, as the guy who is about to be lapped, better get into the pits, because you're definitely going to lose a bit of time as you are being lapped, since you're moving out of the way, and that usually costs you about a second, maybe 2 seconds. And De Bruin now under heavy attack by Dealey. Dealey getting closer by the hour, no, by the minute, no, by the second. Very close indeed. Nick Dealey is now obviously trying to make a move in one of the next turns. And let's see how long Theo De Bruin can actually defend his position number 15, against Flying Dutchman Development's Nick Dealey in 16 and Carlos Costa for AB Racing, watching as these two battle.
He's much, much later on the brakes.
Definitely, definitely.
Almost scary.
Yeah, but then again, out of the turns, Theo de Bruin is... Oh, now he misses this as I'm speaking. He does a very strange exit here, but that might in fact be an exit that gives him a lot of speed. No, it isn't. So Dealey again is blocked here artfully by Theo de Bruin as they head out onto the start and finish straight. But I suppose that Dealey can slip into the slipstream and then maybe make a move at the end of the long straight. And we can see race leader Giulietto moving up. Oh, and there is almost a touch here as Dealey is really now trying to get past. And there is the touch. And De Bruin recovers from the touch, but too late. Dealey has moved past, and De Bruin is down.
Oh, and he's off!
Oh, and he's off! And he's off big time, and he flips!
Ouch!
Oh dear, but he recovers, he's still in the race, he's in 17, and his rear wing is still on, so it looks as if he can actually go on, but that Pagani Zonta will be very difficult indeed to handle, so I suppose De Bruin will definitely head into the pits in this lap and let that Zonta be repaired to actually bring it back home in kind of good shape. It looks alright from the outside, and you never know, but it's probably quite dented as far as the suspension and everything goes, So let's see what Tio does at the end of this lap.
Another potential fight we have is between Candela Blue for the Black Rebels and Team Candela for Water Blue Racing. They are fighting for 6th and 7th. Well, not fighting yet, but Andre is closing and closing all the time.
So everybody's pretty much doing their own race at the top. Just to fill you in on the positions, it's Marco Giuliato for Corus Online in 1, it's Mike Simeon in 2, it's Tyler Skerlop for Flying Dutchman in 3, and it's Ben Tusting also for Flat Out in 4, followed by Jesper Talborg for Flying Dutchman in 5. So still,
guys,
at the moment,
Mike
it's
Simeon
the Flat Out guys. Yes, sorry, who's in the pits?
Mike Simeon.
Mike Simeon, the first of the... top guys here moving into the pits, and it
and
will be
Ben
interesting
Tusting.
To see.
Ben Tusting.
Well. So both of the eggs in the pits, so they also follow exactly the same strategy. Will be interesting to see where they come out with respect to the Flying Dutchman guys, because obviously the Dutchman haven't chosen the two-stop strategy that the other Corvette team has chosen, that Gubkloppen has chosen, and this will really be interesting. And I don't think we have. A solution to the overall standings until something like 20 minutes or so from the finish, because it will only be then that Gubkloppen will head in for the second stop, won't it?
Anyway, Gert, now it's important. Let's see where the flat-out cars rejoin, because they are supposed to be faster now on fresh tires, but if they get some traffic on track, it could be a problem for them.
Yep, and Simeon is out in 8. But he does have a lot of breathing space. There's nothing in the front and there's nothing in the back. It was absolutely ideal. Whoever called him in did an absolutely great job. There's nothing there. And
Mike
he can
has
set.
9 seconds gap with the car in front of him.
Yeah, brilliant, brilliant. That means he can really push for it now. Really, really push for it and try to gain 1 or 2 seconds here on the other teams. Absolutely perfect.
Julia stays out.
Yep. And let's see where Tusting is. Tusting is in 11.
Tusting is 11, and the gap with the car in front is like 5 seconds. So
guys,
pressure.
Ethan Bass looks to be out of the race. He has stopped by the side of the track.
Yep,
he's out.
Guys, Tyler Scarlock, P2 at pit, and Theo De Bruyne as well.
Okay, Theo, definitely that Zonta is still in a fighting shape because he stayed out for another lap, and
sorry, Eckart, but both Flying Dutchman cars at pit right now. Kevin Ledoux,
okay.
Who was in position 5 at pit, Dink André at pit, Matthias Klein at pit, looks like everybody's pitting right now.
Okay,
it's just
and
the half of the race.
Do we have Mike Simeon on the screen? Because here he is going down the straight, and
no,
we see the
before.
First of the Flying Dutchman pitting out. And he's definitely managed to keep that Flying Dutchman behind him. We've seen it so many times this season that the Koenigseggs were very slow in the pits. Yes, David.
But Eckart, he still managed to got the Flying Dutchman behind, but the gap has been reduced a lot.
It has, okay.
Yeah, a lot. It was like 10 seconds around 10 seconds before the pit stop. Now it is 4 seconds between Mike and Tyler Skurlock, and remember, Tyler's tires are one lap newer.
Yeah, 2, I think. Even Giuliato into the pits. Race leader Marco Giuliato goes into the pits, and that means the new race leader is Robin Johansson on his two pit strategy. If he manages to pass Giuliato, let's see. He is now in that section where he starts entering the long turn that leads directly into the start and finish straight. So we actually might see Team Gubkloppen in position number 1 in half a second.
A small update on the fight for 5th in the championship between the Water Blue Racing and the Black Rebels.
Okay.
And Dink André passed Kevin Ledoux in the pits. Still, Water Blue Racing only has 1 car in the race, and TBR has 2, so... Anyway, Dink André is doing his best to seal that 5th place.
Guys,
and just to
very
keep
interesting.
Our viewers informed, yes.
Sorry again for interrupting, but
never mind.
Mike Simeon and Tyler Skurlock both of them managed to overtake Marco Giulietto.
In the pits.
Yeah,
and Robin Johansson is in position number one, so we have a completely new lineup here. It's Johansson in one, it's Mike Simeon in two, it's Tyler Skerlock in three, and Marco Giulietto, but very close behind Skerlock in four, Ben Tusting in five, Göran Johansson in six, Jesper Talborg in seven. So it is the three top teams. Both cars, both players are still in the top seven, and Marco Giulietto in between them, but now down to four, and maybe, of course, trying to get back to that top position, but he now has to get past Talborg, and he has to get past Simeon, so that'll be very difficult indeed.
Eckhart, we have Mikael Larsson, Terius at pits, and we had Nick Dilley and Carlos Costa a little while ago. I think everybody did already their pit stop, Eckhart.
It looks like it, it looks like it. It's and it may just be, it may just be, it might figure out that the Gubklubbens don't need a second pit stop. Andreas, what do you think? Was that a very early pit stop, then they just put in as much fuel as possible and then they can run home now?
Well, yeah, it's possible. Or maybe they changed it to one stopper now that they saw how it went with the others in the pits.
Yep.
But they will suffer heavily on the tires the last 15 minutes or something like that.
Especially with the Corvette.
Especially with the Corvette.
I am checking the gap between Mike Simeon and Robin Johansson.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah,
and looks like Mike Simeon is reducing it quite fast. So I doubt Robin managed to keep the distance without doing a second stop. And if they stop for a second time, possibly he will fall to position 6, 7, possibly.
Yeah, definitely. Okay guys, we're in P8, just a rundown here of the top 7 positions before we do a rundown of 9 to the back of the field. Position number 1, as I just said, Robin Johansson, followed by Mike Simeon in 2 for Flat Out, followed by Tyler Skerlock in 3 for Gubklubben, followed by Marco Giulietto for Course Online, who led the race, but is now down to 4 after the pit stops. In 5, Ben Tusting for Flat Out, in 6, Göran Johansson for Gubklubben, and then in 7, Jesper Talborg for the Flying Dutchman. And this is the closest fight on the grid at the moment. Matthias Klein being chased by Dinka Andre. We should really stay with these before we do the rundown. Yes, guys, you are definitely right to pick that fight, because Klein is under immense pressure. Andre, who tries to one way or the other get past. And why is Andre in such a hurry? Because in the overall standings, Waterblue Racing are just 2 points away from the Black Rebels. Waterblue at 227 and 5, Black Rebels in six for 225. And that is, of course, he's trying to get as many points as possible, and he really must get past Matthias Klein here as quickly as possible.
Eckhart.
And there it goes.
Yes, David.
Yes, I have some interesting information. And it is that Tyler Skerlock made the fastest lap of the race.
Oh, brilliant. Gives him a point.
Yeah, it's 1:38.515 in the previous lap. The next lap, the last one, have been very fast as well. And compared with Mike Simeon pace right now, I would say that the Flying Dutchman is recovering some of the gap that they already reduced with the pit stop, so possibly we will have a fight in some laps.
Brilliant. And Ilsbrooks just gave me a message here, Tom, thank you very much, on some statistics saying that the Flat Out had 8 pole positions this season out of 10 possible ones. That's absolutely breathtaking. And they also had 6 fastest laps so far. At the moment, we just hear it's the Flying Dutchman, so Flat Out, do your job and see if you can regain that fastest lap time, because it gives you an extra point here in the sim racing team challenge. Well then, here's the rundown since Andre managed to get past Matthias Klein. Matthias Klein for Torrent, the only remaining Torrent guy on the grid, in position number 9. Position number 10 goes to Kevin Ledoux for the Black Rebels. Position number 11 goes to Per Akterios for Gubkluben UD. And this is the closest fight at the moment on the grid, so let's stay with these two guys for at least half a lap. It's Mikael Larsson, who I earlier on put in the Gubkluben team. Sorry, Mikael, who of course is with... let me think. What was the name of that team again? Yes, with Blue Flag Racing. And it's a poor Mika. I even, when I signed up the players 2 nights ago, I signed him as Mikale. Mikale Larsson. So you're Italian after all, my friend. Yes, Mikael Larsson. And I just noticed that this afternoon when I checked who was going to be on the grid tonight, I said, who on earth is Mikael Larsson? Anyway, here he is, Mikael Larsson. We call him Mikael on the forum. And Mikael is now very close indeed and making a fantastic move here on, I think, Per Akterios for Gubkluben UD. Let's see what the Zonta can do down the straight against the Gumpert. It can do a lot, as in a picture book move. Larsson slips by. This should go into any textbook on how to overtake. Take good speed out of the last turn, conserve it one way or the other through the straight, and then use it at the end of the turn wisely. Well done, Mikael Larsson. That settles that. Akterios down in 12 and in 13. Following them, we have Gregory De Graeff. Still trying to recover from that horrible crash at the start there that caught us all by surprise. In 14, second of the Gubkluben UD, Collis Ström. 15, Nick Deely, who has just been lapped, it looks, by Ben Tusting. 16, Carlos Costa for AB Racing in their home race here. 17, Andy Roberts for the Flat Out Club. 18, another home racer, Joao Castellos for Sonic. 19, Theo De Bruin, who survived a flip after a touch with Nick Deely earlier on. So Theo, if you still feel a little shaken, only fair, that looked absolutely horrible. And that's it. That's your grid. We're down to 19 from 25, so that's six guys out of the game here. That was four in the starting crash and two in between.
While you were doing the rundown, Jesper Tarberg got past Göran Johansson for six.
Thank you very much.
And also Julia is getting closer to Tyler Skerlock for third.
And I just got a little touch here by Reggie Blaine. He says that maybe Dinka Andre got a stop and go. And so that, let's see how that plays out. And Chausse, could we move the camera to 8 and 9?
Well, yeah, he's gone in that battle.
Brilliant, because that's the battle between Kevin Ledoux and Matthias Klein. Matthias Klein, who had to slip. Had to let Andre pass earlier on, but Andre now with that stop and go out of the way, he is under huge pressure from Kevin Ledoux. I mean, poor Matthias. He's just resolved the one battle and he thinks, okay, that guy is into the pits and out of the way, but here comes Kevin Ledoux and out on the straight they go. Oh, and Ledoux tries to get some slipstream. He noticed that he couldn't make it pass without. Now he's taking the speed of the slipstream out into the brake zone. Ooh, into T1 they go. Little touch there. And Matthias tries to hold on, tries to battle pass, but late on the brakes, both of them. Ledoux magnificently stays in control here and makes that move stick. Well, open your textbooks again, folks. That was another one. Well done, Kevin Ledoux. Well done, Matthias Klein as well. It's always two who play the game here, and Matthias Klein did everything right. He tried to put the pressure back on Ledoux the moment Ledoux was passed, but Ledoux also definitely knew what he was doing and resisted that push there by Matthias Klein, and he stays in position number 8 while Klein is down to 9. David, are you still with me?
Yes, of course I can.
Brilliant. Can I send you to our timing screen again? Because I'd be really interested in the gaps, because I see that if we go back to 1, 2, 3 and 4, we'll see that they're closing in on Robin Johansson. He is definitely being hunted down here by the pack.
Yes, yes, of course, of course. Mike Simon is just 3 seconds far from Robin.
Ooh, not good.
And there are still 33 minutes to go, so Robin will have no chance at all to keep on position 1. But Tyler is also closing the gap with Mike. They are only separated by a couple of seconds.
Okay.
So it will become really interesting. And back with Ben Tasting and Jesper Talborg, we have a gap of 12 seconds between them, more or less. Will be
okay, so that's
a bit more difficult.
Yep. That's a big one. And we see, as if we follow number 1, Robin Johansson, this guy is really having huge trouble with that Corvette, trying to make it do. Oh, and we have a spin in the back by Gubklub and UD. We have a spin in the back, and this brings Tyler Skerlock, under pressure from Marco Giuliani.
Was a touch, actually. Tyler was trying to pass the Gubklub and UD car. Wasn't really doing right with the blue flags.
Sorry, Chassé, I will interrupt you. One second. We have Robin Johansson at pit right now.
There is a two-stopper.
Forgot to mention, but Marco Giulietto is like three-tenths of a second behind Tyler.
Yes, and he's now attacking. Yeah. He's at the side of Tyler Skerlock and he's passed Giulietto. There's a little touch there. But that was a clean move by Marco Giulietto, a very daring but still a clean move. Tyler Skerlock is not very happy. He's flashing his lights at Marco Giulietto, but from what I could see, it was a close move. It was a very, very tough move. I don't think, though, it was unfair. That was the tiniest bit of space opening in the brake zone, and he went in. And he secured that position. And now we have the same situation that we had at the beginning of the race. We have Giulietto chasing down Simeon, and he's not far away. He's only like 2 or 3 seconds away.
Yeah, I think this case, the FDR driver was a bit frustrated because of what happened before with the lap car. And that's why his reaction.
Yeah, because that,
the movement
that really
was okay.
Yep, that really brought Giulietto within striking range, and he used it. The moment he had it, he used it. There was the chance, and he took it. So well
by the
done.
Way, Eckhart, yeah, Marco Giulietto is the fastest guy on track, and he
definitely
made the fastest lap of the race.
Brilliant.
A couple of laps ago with a 1:38.257, and he's flying. He's flying on track, so
he's
possibly
definitely
will catch Mike in maybe 5-6 laps.
Yep, my suggestion too. Also, if we take into consideration what happened at the beginning of the race, Simeon could stand, could stick to position number 1 for quite a long time, but then there came a time when obviously the Koenigsegg was eating the tires, while the Audi stayed pretty much clear of that problem, and Giulietto could still pass. So let's see what happens here. Well then, we have Simeon 1 with 32 points at the moment. And we have Giulietto in 2, we have Skerlock in 3, that is worth 26 points. We have Tusting in 4 for 23 points. We have Talborg in 5 for 22 points. And Gubklub, I'm sorry to say, your best guy is Robin Johansson in 6 for 21 points. And Göran Johansson in 9 for 18 points. So that means that at the moment, Flat Out Racing would get 56 if you count in the qualification, 56 points. The Flying Dutchman would get 48, and the Gutkloven would get 39 points. So that would mean that, yes, we would have flat out as champions, Gutkloven in two, flat out as champions, Flying Dutchman in two, von Glahn, take it easy, and Gutkloven in three. So nothing would change in the overall standings, just that the gaps would be a bit further than before. But it's not the end of the day, it's not the end of the race. A lot can still happen in the last, what I would think, maybe 20 minutes or 25 minutes.
Yeah, I think at this point, it's flat out losing the championship.
Yep.
Something happened. I mean, they just need to bring the two cars home, and they will be fine.
And if I were simply...
We are trying to keep it a bit exciting here.
Yeah, well. That's the difference between the cameraman and the commentator.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, I hate when the Formula One commentators do that. When there is...
Theo de Bruyne. Theo de Bruyne touched by Marco Giuliato, and now Giuliato. Now Skurlock touching Giuliato.
It's the same
place they were in before. Second touch by Skurlock. Doesn't take advantage of it though.
Did you see how close Simeon was to actually crash into the Bruyne's car?
Yep. Oh. Yep. Theo really mixes up the field here.
Marco was getting really close. He was in less than 2 seconds from Mike.
Yep.
This incident changed everything, because now Marco is like 4 seconds and a half behind Mike, and Tyler is like 5 seconds. They have lost a lot of time.
Yep. And if Tyler is, Tyler's at on the edge now, he might actually try to make a move, because Giuliato will be quite ruffled. Giuliato will possibly have lost his rhythm, and let's see what Tyler Skurlock can do in the next lap. If he wants to make a move, it has to be in this lap, and after this lap, Giuliato will be back in stride, he will have found his rhythm, and Skurlock's chance will have passed. So he realized that this was going on. He was really trying to make a move there, but artfully defending here at Marco Giuliato. And Tyler touched him twice, and Tyler then decided to not push the envelope too far, and decided to stay out of trouble and not take advantage of these half spins that he caused. And he's now following Giuliato. They're getting close to where the action was, a lap down. And Giuliato has recovered. He is back in stride. He has found his rhythm. And look at that. He is now opening the gap again to Tyler Skurlock. Ooh, and that's racing, isn't it? Things can happen.
Exactly. Yep. You wanted it to be tidying?
No, I would never. I would hate racing to be tidy. I want it to be fair. I want it to be close. And I want some surprises in there.
Okay, guys, if you want to know what lap time Marco had when the accident happened, he was like 4 seconds off pace from his personal best.
Oh, dear.
But still, he's flying again, and I think he will recover the distance he lost, because he's being way faster than Mike right now.
Yep, will it be enough though? How much time do we have left in the game?
We have time enough, Eckhart. It's 25 minutes left.
Ah,
so
brilliant.
I am sure
brilliant.
they will collide again during the race.
Collide?
catch up,
yeah. Then, first they will catch up, then they will collide.
No, that's all not. How much did you pay him?
No, Andreas did, because to make it more exciting.
Ah, yes, I thought you were asking to Andreas.
Yeah, of course.
He's the man doing the dirty job here.
Yeah, meet me in the alley after the race.
Andy Roberts in pits, by the way, and that looks like a drive-through penalty, or a stop-and-go penalty, sorry. Yep, stop and go. Andy Roberts out on the track again. And let me tell you, I've just checked the grid. Not a single fight.
I was checking the same thing.
And Andy Roberts nearly crashes as he heads out of the pits. Possibly it wasn't on your screen, it was on my screen because I was going back up the grid again. Joao Castellos was just coming down into turn one as Andy Roberts was leaving. And that was very, very close indeed.
Yeah, he put himself between Maximian and Giuliato.
Yep.
Ah, now he moves out. So, good work there.
And Simeon now coming up to a good club in UD. And trying to find a way past. Oh well, a bit of a breathing space here for us commentators. Andreas, if you look back on the Sim Racing Team Challenge, the last, what was it, 7 seasons, 8 seasons? I don't even remember how many there were. There were many. What's the basic idea? If you look back, what characterized the Sim Racing Team Challenge? This is a bit like final last words here.
I think we can sum it up with the name of the championship, because it really is a team championship. Yeah, I mean I'm not good with the words.
okay.
But okay. You know, you can't put only two guys in the team and race for a championship, because you have to have at least four of them.
Yep.
Or is it more? Is it six? No. I think you can manage with four drivers.
Okay, that would be the least, because everybody's allowed five events, so four would be the minimum number, but I think most of the teams here have like six, seven, eight guys in their stables, and yeah, that seems to have been what the leading teams, what set them apart, is that no matter what happened, they always had somebody who is lightning fast on the grid.
Yep. Oh, and of course, you know, fair racing, and as well as the teams having they can give input, you know, like the war system.
Yep.
Which I think Shazir once said was groundbreaking.
Yep, I'm very proud of it.
Yeah, you know, and well organized as well, and yeah, top of the notch.
Yeah, we even won last. You remember last year we won the race department special prize for the best series of the year. We were very happy with that. Thank you very much again, everybody who voted for us. We of course feel we had it deserved, but still, it was a very nice surprise to be awarded that trophy. And yes, I totally agree with you. Sim racing as a team, that really sets this challenge apart. And yeah, we've seen huge battles here, and we've seen absolutely fantastic teams, haven't we? Danielson Motorsports, they were with us for a couple of seasons. They won twice, I think.
No, once.
Sure. Once. They were very, very close, at least two or three times. And we've had the Roaring Pipes Maniacs, who were the first champions.
Yeah, back in 2008.
Yep, seems like, I mean, in internet time, this is like 50 years ago.
Yeah, pretty much.
Feels like it. And we've had DHR, Danumain Racing, who left after season 6 or 5 or something, but they won, I think, twice.
Yep.
Flat Out, who very nearly dropped out because they had a dreadful season when we had some problems with the mod. And they were struck hardest. I think their second team, the Flat Out Club, they couldn't even finish a single race that season without any disconnect and trouble to get onto the grid and whatever. They picked such a nice car, the Scirocco, and it never worked.
No, that was a dreadful car.
It looked nice.
Yep.
And but that the car was the problem, obviously. There was something wrong with the mod in that year. And then we went for the Doran. Then we have 3 seasons of the Doran. And so we only took one car for the championship. And then the big time of a Flat Out started, and they won the last 2 championships. So they're not only the defending champions, they're defending champions times 2. And they are the new champions, let me tell you. There is very little that can stop them from being the new champions here at the Portimao, with Mike Simeon still in one, Ben Tosting still in four. So they're still liable to collect 56 points at the end of the race.
What, now you have been talking about previous championships and previous...
Yep.
What do you think, guys, was the best combination so far? In my opinion, or at least for me, it was the season with the Dorans, and I have to say thanks to Chassé because it was his proposal. For me, it was exceptional racing. The car designs were amazing. I enjoyed a lot that series, that years.
Yep, what I like about the Dorans was that everybody really had the same chance, and but we see this time round that even if you let the top teams choose last, so they choose like the slowest cars on the grid, they're still the top teams. It brings the field a little bit closer together, but not really very much. And personally, I never really liked the handling of the Doran. Maybe it was just too difficult for somebody of my size. And I never really got round to really liking the feel of it. And so I wouldn't say the Doran seasons. I would say maybe the second season. The first season we had club cars, and also we had pro cars on different races. So we had one race with the pros, and then in the second race with the club.
The sport.
I think we picked the BMW that time. And then the season after that, the first one with the pro only, that was my favorite season. Don't know why. Possibly because I could still more or less follow the pace. But from that on, people got just so much better and better and better at the top. It was just breathtaking. Oh yeah, personally for me, season number two would have been the best one. Andreas, what about you?
I'm thinking.
I can almost hear it.
did we really only have the GT Pro in season 2?
Suppose, yes. I think we had two classes only once.
No, we had it as well in season 2. I'm checking in the standings.
Ah, you just checked. You're cheating.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry. It must be... No, now I entered the same standings. Oh, we had it for three seasons?
Did
GP4
we?
And GP4? No, wait.
Oh, that can't be, that can't be.
No.
Well, Andreas thinks about
we had a season. We had a season, the blue flag had the Corvette in black. That I think was season number 3. That was lovely,
amazing car.
A lovely ride, and I really liked Suzuka.
Yes,
I was taking part in Suzuka there, and that was one of my best memories. So it was a slippery course, and
you finished
really
second.
Second to last. Yes, thank you, Andreas.
Andreas, yeah,
you're
that
welcome.
Information was not really needed.
I know.
I won't tell you what was my best race so far because I don't want you to tell my final position.
Did you ever take part in any of the races, David?
Yeah, I remember him racing in, was it Dijon, when he ran out of fuel, fighting for second or something like that?
I remember that. We had a good laugh.
Ahead of Rami,
well.
And got out of fuel in the final lap, yeah.
Yeah, well, I think season 3 for me was the best one, even though we had the problems with the mod. As well as we picking the Ferrari, which was pretty crap.
Yeah.
I fondly remember that. Black Rebels have these huge problems with the Ferrari. First of all, you were going like, oh, we got the Ferrari, it's fantastic, wonderful. And then race 1 or 2, the only reaction was, why on earth did we do that?
Yep.
I think that was the reason why we changed to the Doran, because we didn't want to pick the wrong car again.
Yep. No choice means you can't make a wrong choice. So
exactly.
While we're talking, the race is shaping up, heading towards the finish. We have 15 minutes left. There is not much happening at the top of the grid. We still have Simeon in one.
A little bit.
Yeah, but only a very, very little bit. It looks as if he's run out of steam one way or the other. But he had several touches. I mean, this can definitely put you off the pace on the straight, can it? you can actually lose four or five kilometers of top speed if you get touched too much. So that might be a problem for Giuliato, that he has some sort of handling problem after these touches by Tyler Skurlock's Corvette. And it's Skurlock still in three, Tusting still in four, so that's your top four, still the same. Talborg in five, Johansson in six. And so Gubkloppen, yes, they chose a different strategy, and it paid off for some time. And they were race leaders. It looked pretty good, but then they had to realize that tonight simply wasn't the night of the two-stopper. It was definitely the night of the one-stopper. But I admire them. I admire them for at least trying to do something different, at least trying to give it a chance. And you never know what happens, so it might have been the perfect strategy for them. Just one way or the other, it didn't pay off. So, with the season ending, Andreas, where are you heading? No more action in the STC. What's your substitute?
I'm sorry, can you repeat?
Where are you heading sim race? Is there any substitute for the STC? Any new challenge on the horizon for you?
It's called girlfriend.
We're speaking about sim racing, guys.
Yes, yeah, exactly. No, I'm not really sure. I bought iRacing, so maybe I will try to race that a little bit more. But,
oh, brilliant. Yeah, catch me if you can.
Well, maybe it's the other way around. Nah, I'm just kidding.
The other way around is... catch me if I can.
Yeah.
No, you definitely I don't know. You don't know. So
waiting a bit for Factor 2, of course.
Everyone is.
Yeah. And maybe GTR 3, who knows?
Yeah, you never know. It might be a big year for sim racing, because GTR 3 is somewhere in the pipeline. At least we saw that there is life there in Sweden. And R Factor 2, I mean, this has been in the pipeline for ages and ages and ages. And so it might just shape up to be a perfect year for sim racing, might it not?
Yeah, and some nice features and nice new stuff like the Fanatec new wheels.
Yep.
People should get
connected
to Race Department in order to see all the news about sim racing.
Yep, Race Department definitely a place to go. They're our partners here. We have our forum space on Race Department, so this has always been a great partnership with Race Department. Very, very reliable, and always with the broadcasts. And we were with PSRTV for a long, long time before they wholeheartedly switched to iRacing. And we're happy, very happy with our new partners this season, aren't we?
Yes, of course. And I think I have to thank Lutz Enger from Simrace TV, because he does way more than expected. I mean, he always does 200% to help you, and that's always something to be grateful for.
Yep, so huge big thanks here at the end of the final season to Simrace TV. Also a big thank you for PSRTV for covering the final one, maybe even, did we cover the first season in broadcasts, or did we start that in season number two?
I think...
First season.
First season. All the broadcasts are available on our website.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Someone should actually download them and burn them and keep them for posterity. And then when I turn 75, you can give them to me as a present.
Yeah, but more than this, I think most or every single broadcast is available on YouTube as well.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah,
I never even checked.
it is in this format as well in the STC site, which is really nice. You can watch them live with no need of download them.
Yep, save space on the old
hard
drive.
By the way, sorry, Eckhart, little interruption. We have Marco Giuliato just 1 second far from Mike Simon and 9 minutes to go.
He's making a lot of push now, I think.
Yeah.
And the closest five and six. We have Jesper Talborg attacked here by Göran Johansson. No, by by Robin Johansson. And Johansson just slipped past, and Talborg defended artfully because Johansson overshot just slightly. This looks so great. We should have done a whole season with only Corvettes. They look just fantastic. And here comes Johansson again on the inside of that long and twisty turn, and out they go, and Talborg is on the rumble strips. Talborg has to slot in behind Johansson, but there's
we have to remember that Robin is on better tires, newer tires, so possibly the speed difference is because of that.
Yeah, and, but we have to remember the stream. Watch out.
Yeah.
Here they go. Ah, Talborg doesn't make a move. Because
very talented drivers, both of them.
Oh, both of them absolutely perfect. We've seen beautiful sim racing from both of them here as the season progresses. And oh, look at how Robin Johansson just hoists his Corvette around those turns. It was more like Richard Burns, really. And sliding all over the place, that, of course, eats your tires like nothing. And again here, just throwing the car into that hairpin and sliding round. And look at the difference to Skurlock already.
Sorry,
to Talborg. Yep, Andreas.
We now have a fight for P1.
We definitely have. Definitely have. So, Jose,
half a second.
Hop off to P1 and P2. And if Simeon is a clever guy, there's not much of a fight.
Well, because let's hope there is a fight.
No. In this case, let's hope there is not a fight, because I wouldn't want to see the championship decided by a fight here for position number one between one of the title contenders and a team that is a very fast team, a very fair team, but at this point in the championship, not one of the title contenders.
But
so let's hope that Simeon plays it safe. And there goes
Giulietto.
What a touch there. That wasn't clean at all.
He gives the place back.
That wasn't clean at all. And here comes... Is it De Graeff or is it Ledoux? I think it's De Graeff. Here comes Skurlock. Oh my goodness. De Graeff gets out of the way. Skurlock slots back in. What a lot of argy-bargy here with 7 minutes to go.
For a moment it looked to me like maybe Marco thought Mike was giving him room to pass,
avoiding
a fight. And he made the move, and then Mike Simeon closed the door.
Well, yeah, but he had every right to, because he was still in front. But that's exactly what it looked to me. I thought, okay, here goes Mike, opening the door and letting him slip past. And then he just finished the move. He just turned in, which is perfectly okay, because it was his turn. All right, he was well ahead. And then Giulietto really had no place to go. So...
Judging by Simeon's reaction to the overtaking try by Giulietto, I think Simeon really wants to win this one.
He wants to go out on a P1. I can understand that. I can fully understand that. At the end of the race, at the end of the day, you're out there to win the race, aren't you?
But this is still a team challenge. They should consider.
It's racing.
Well, yeah, of course, but they are risking a lot, Eckhart, you know, it's...
And no risk, no fun.
5 minutes to go.
Yeah,
it's pretty much Prost mentality against...
And out goes Giulietto, trying to lap Dinka Andre. Out goes Giulietto. There was a misunderstanding there between Dinka Andre and Marco Giulietto, and Andre lets Giulietto take that position, waits for him. That was clearly not a bad move by Dinka Andre. That was a clear misunderstanding again in pretty much the same place where we had the misunderstanding.
I think
it was more or less the same misunderstanding.
I think it was next corner than the previous incident.
Yep, one further down, I think
T4, T4, exactly. And I think it was a misunderstanding. I agree with you, Eckhart.
Again.
It looked like Dink Andrei was letting him take the apex of the corner, and then they collided in there. I can't understand what happened, really.
Yep, true. I mean, poor Marco, the second time... In almost two laps, the same thing happens. It looks as if he's being let through, and nothing happens the moment he gets close. So that must be very frustrating indeed. This is really his race to lose tonight.
Bad luck for Course Online and Marco especially, because possibly if we count only the pace, he was the one to win the race, but well, this is racing and a lot of things can happen.
And Jose, do you still have time to go to 7 and 8? I mean, the race is almost finished, but only almost. And here we have Kevin Ledoux putting the Martek, the Ford Martek, through its paces, fighting against the Apollo Gumpert of Matthias Klein, who is really trying to make a push here, trying to get into that position number 7, and it is very close racing indeed by these two here. And they have been at it for at least 3 or 4 laps now. And Ledoux defending for all he's worth. You can see it in these huge white smoky tires, these smoke clouds that go up from Ledoux in every brake zone. So he's really pushing that Martek to the limits. And Klein is waiting for his chance, but putting the pressure on as well.
Guys, this is a whisper. I will be checking the clock, and I will be checking when we are going into the last lap.
Race Direction says it'll keep an eye on the clock so you're not missing the final triumphant lap for Mike Simeon, but at the moment we are where the action is, and this is Kevin Ledoux. He's just now lapping Theo de Bruin, who didn't have the best of luck with being lapped tonight. And Ledoux now has gained a little again to Matthias Klein. Every time we move our camera here, Ledoux doesn't know that he's on the screen. Because every time we move the camera there, he's pulling away from Klein. Oh, look at that. There's just completely blocks up the inside tires there as he goes into that hairpin. Not good for the tires, Kevin. Race Direction, my ear, tells me 2 more laps to go. So say bye-bye to the STC. So while you guys are watching them fighting for 6 and 7, and Dinka Andre is in the pits again, I will give you, without the camera, a rundown of who is still with us here in the last race, in the last 2 laps of the Sim Racing Team Challenge ever. Andy Roberts is still with us in 19 for Flat Out Club. Theo de Bruin is still with us for Blue Flag Racing in 18. Colin Ström is still with us for Gubclub UD in 17. Joao Castellos is still with us for Sonic Racing in 16. Carlos Costa still with us for AB Racing in 15. Nick Dealey in 14 for Flying Dutchman Development. Dinka Andre still with us in 13. Moving down the grid, I'm afraid. Poor Dinka. For Waterloo Racing, Mikkel Larsson in 12.
Eckhart,
blue flag.
Yes. Sorry for interrupting again. We are starting the final lap right now.
Thank you very much. I'm finishing my rundown here. Actarios, Per Actarios in 11. De Graaf in 10. Johansson, sliding wildly in 9. Matthias Klein in 8. Kevin Ledoux in 7. And the camera should move up to position number 1 now. 6 for Jesper Thalborg. 5 for Robin Johansson. 4 for Ben Tusting. 3, Marco Giuliato at this time. 2, Tyler Skerlock. And position number 1, Mike Simeon, who really takes it easy in this last lap. Tyler Skerlock has closed the gap considerably. Simeon definitely not taking it easy if you look at what's going on in that brake zone here, but he wants to bring home a final win for the defending champions for Flat Out Racing. I can see Tom Ilsbrooks getting up at this point. Champagne ready, rushes to the fridge. Is it nice and cold, Tom? You can already start fiddling with the cork. Only like 40 seconds or so before you can celebrate a 3rd consecutive championship for Flat Out in the Sim Racing Team Challenge. And 2nd position for the Flying Dutchman, for Tyler Skerlock. He is getting closer
and closer,
but it won't be enough. It will be enough for a nice close finish on our screens. And Jose says, thank you for Mike. To Mike, and here comes Mike, out of the last turn, well, into the last turn, first of all. And now, out of the last turn, for the last time in the Sim Racing Team Challenge, we have a winner, and this is Mike Simeon for Flat Out Racing. There he goes, Tyler Skerlock in two for the Flying Dutchman. In three, Marco Giuliato, the unlucky man of this race. In position number four, Ben Tusting. And now he's going through the last turn here, and he flashes the lights. He knows he's in the championship winning team. Position number five, Robin Johansson. That two-stop strategy was a wager, and it didn't quite pay off. Jesper Talborg in six for the Flying Dutchman, slowing down here. And we still have a fight for seven, for eight, for nine. We still have seven. Kevin Ledoux of the Black Rebels in the yellow car. And he is followed by Matthias Klein, but Matthias Klein is about to be attacked by Göran Johansson in the very, very, very last turn. Matthias Klein defending against Johansson here in the last turn of the last championship. But I think he can make it stick. Let's have a look. Well, Johansson does have slipstream going uphill. Klein moves to the side. Ooh, that was so close. That was so close. Thank you, Matthias, and thank you, Göran, for a really close finish. And that was it. Those were the last players in one lap. That's it, guys. We have the interviews up next in about a minute. So, a bit of time has passed, and with us now is not the whole podium, but we're starting out with the guy who won the very, very last race of the STC ever to secure the third title for his team. Mike Simeon, how does it feel?
Thank that guy, man. It feels great. It feels really good. The pressure was certainly on tonight, and the car felt shit, and the track was hard, but managed to bring it home in first. I really wasn't looking to take the win tonight, and I would have let Marco pass at the end, but I'm so unlucky that I got caught up with a back marker.
But that was a bit of a very, very close scene there. It could have, you know, totally turned the whole championship, upended it totally, and had we would have had a totally different result.
Yeah, well, that's it. You know, I let Marco pass in the first stint. He was obviously quicker than me, so I was going to do it again once he got close enough, and just as he was getting close, back marker there made contact and he was off the track, so I was very lucky to take the win there.
Okay, but fast as well, and a third championship in a row, so there must be something about you Flat Out guys that sets you apart. And with us now, Tyler Skerlock, who finished the race in position number two, started in three. Tyler, how did it feel out there tonight?
It felt like I was slow. too slow.
How come? To us, you looked very fast indeed.
Well, I didn't win.
So, oh, but still, you ended up in two, and you had the fastest lap time for a long time.
Oh, I didn't get it at the end?
Suppose not. I'm not quite sure Davita has a better grip on that, but I think it was Marco who had the fastest time. But
okay.
Anyway, how did you see that situation between Mike and Marco? Could you watch it? Were you close enough?
I was just close enough. I couldn't keep up myself. I wanted to try and stay close enough to where I could capitalize on some sort of opportunity. But just wasn't. Not for the lead anyways, but for second. I was close enough.
Okay, and I just had a message here from Robin Johansson saying that indeed the fastest time was him, so thank you, Robin, for setting that straight. I think we're still waiting for Marco Giuliato, but since he's not arriving here, a big question to both Mike and Tyler. What's your next plans now, once the STC is over and done with for good? Where is your team heading?
Oh, I don't know, really, mate. I think we're all going to take a long break and then see what the next thing is. I think wait for R-Factor 2 and maybe cars and see how that works out. And I do hope that we've not seen the last of STC, because it's been a great championship to be involved in, and thoroughly enjoyed it. And thanks to all you guys for all the hard work, etc. It's been brilliant.
Thank you very much. Tyler, where is Flying Dutchman headed?
I think Flying Dutchman is all over the place, but mostly we'll be at Sim Racing Pro doing the BTCC challenge and simulator touring car challenge.
Okay, sounds
and,
great.
Hopefully, someone can take over STC and we can see it again.
It was a nice concept, wasn't it, with the teams being in the focus and not the individual. I mean, at the end of the day, it's always the individual who has to go out there and do the job, but it feels different, does it, doing it for the team?
Yeah, I think the pressure is on, definitely, when it's for a team. You know, you can't, it's not just yourself. Whenever I race for myself, I'm not too worried, but for STC, seriously, every qualifying session, my legs are shaking, my arms are shaking, and I can't drive properly, you know? So the pressure's really on when it's for a team, and I think that sets it apart from everything else, and yeah, I'll miss it. I do hope we see it again.
Let's see, and now with us is third positioned Marco Giuliato, who for a long time was the fastest man out there on the grid. Congratulations on three, Marco Giuliato. Not your best night tonight. Very unlucky, weren't you?
No, it was my best night, but someone destroyed my work, because it's impossible to drive like some people. I'm very, very disappointed for this night, for the result of this night. Because it is not possible a similar thing. I think it's impossible to drive like this.
Yeah, it's unfortunate for you, Marco. I was hoping you could make it past me. I didn't want to lose too much time, and I was hoping you could make it past me in the last lap or something without me losing time. And then
in the last lap, three lap to the end, or four lap to the end. Because if I don't have the problem that I have with some drivers, I can close the gap with you, I think, 10 laps before the end.
Yeah, I understand, yeah.
So there were some incidents, Marco, but you were on a very good pace, that's a fact. You were very fast during the race,
What changed that I was fast? I was fast, but I go out caused for not
yeah,
for my
course,
mistake, but for the mistake
of.
Of course,
at the end you didn't have luck, but well, your performance was superb despite what happened, Marco. So I think you should be happy, and we can only congratulate you for the good race you
okay,
did.
Okay, thank you, boys. But I'm sure I'm not happy. Really.
No, we can understand that. Yeah, it's always difficult, isn't it? It was your race to lose, really. You were the fastest guy out there for a long time. You weren't in the end, because the Group Club just told us that they caught the fastest lap towards the end of the race. But then things didn't play out the way they should have, and there were incidents, and at the end of the day, you ended up in three. So bad luck to you, Marco Giuliano, but thank you very much for popping into the studio anyway, because I know it's very difficult to talk if you really are very, very angry about what was going on the track. So thanks very much for popping in here.
You're welcome, Mike.
All right, so this is it then. Yes,
yes, Eckhart, I think we should move, instead of they coming here, I think we should move to the Champions channel, to the Flat Out channel, and celebrate with them. Like, I think it's worth it.
If we can do that technically, I have
no clue. Yeah, of course. In 2 seconds, you just have to go to the Flat Out Racing channel, and that's all.
Okay, off we go then. But before we move there, thank you very much, Marco. Thank you very much, Tyler, for joining us in the interview. Sorry again, Marco, for that not very happy race of yours. And thank you, Tyler Skerlock, for finishing the race in position number 2. Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Cheers.
Joins now.
So here we are, Eckhart.
Yeah, we are in the Flat Out room, and I can see there's champagne all over the place. How does it feel? Three-time champion.
There's a lot of people in here.
I didn't get the beers in. I didn't want to tempt fate tonight, so I didn't get the beers in and ready for a celebration, so I need to get a shot.
Well, we left the door.
We've got virtual champagne.
Who is in charge of the music, guys? Because it's quite silent for a party.
Mikkel.
Come on,
yeah, it's Mikkel.
He's probably playing the Finnish top 2 to us. David, I'm very happy that you brought Timi along, because I know that Mikko in particular likes him very much.
Yes,
say hello,
course,
Timi.
Yes, of course. I have to open the jail. Timmy is.
Oh, no, not this, Christ! Can we not move David out of the channel now?
You can't. He's the race direction.
Here we go.
Hello, Mika. Hello, Mika. How are you, Mike?
Okay, guys, I think with this wonderful laugh of Timmy, we will leave you for good. We will leave the Flat Outs to celebrate. At least I'm off the air in 10 seconds or so.
Anyway,
congratulations. This was it. This was the STC. Yes, David.
Before you close it, we have...
Yes,
as
you
well,
have close it.
Hugo Heckenberg here with us. The
can I just... I don't know if you can hear this. Can you?
Yeah.
No.
No.
Nope. Yeah.
Just a little bit. I think it's we are the champions from Queen, but just half of a second. I am very good with music. So I think I would like to hear some words from Hugo. He is leading the team, the second team in the standings, fighting till the end. Would like to know how was the end for them and some words from Hugo.
It was a pretty heavy race. We had a lot of disconnects during the whole season, but we were standing pretty good at the start. And at the end, I'm still sweating. So if we were getting a 1 and 2 tonight, and the other team has got a 3 and a 10, we would win. But unfortunately,
when's that going to happen? The Flat Out.
I don't know. I did a great job, and I want to congratulate them with the championship. It was very good.
Congratulations to you guys as well. You know, it was really close, and it's a shame STC's finished. But I hope we get a chance to race each other again.
Are we live on Telly now?
Yep, we are.
Okay.
Hello, everybody.
I also want to say thank you to everybody here.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks to you guys as well. And,
Freddie at last, and Freddie Mercury takes us out of this tumultuous season and out of this mad room here that's called the Flat Out Home. You guys go on celebrating. I'm off enjoying the rest of the evening, and this was it. Another interesting bye-bye. Season has I'm finished. Bye-bye. See you all, folks. This is Eckhard von Glanz speaking. Bye-bye, José.
Remember to kill the squirrel.
Keep the terrible idea.
Bye-bye, Andreas.
Bye-bye.
And bye-bye, Resurrection David Garcia.
Bye-bye, Eckhard, and...
Bye-bye, as well.